Welcome to the one-day seminar discussion today on colonial legacy in the Netherlands and Indonesia. My name's Max Lane, one of the initiators of this day, and I'd just like to say welcome to everybody, and maybe just take 1 minute to explain a bit of the background of how this event came about. There was a public lecture last year at the International Institute of Social History on political radicalization in the left-wing sense in Indonesia, which attracted quite a good solid audience. And after that discussion, it was actually Jan Breman, one of our first speakers, who said to me, because we were discussing the rise of populist right-wing racism in the Netherlands and around the world, he said, in the Netherlands, the question of racism will never be able to be properly confronted unless the legacies and the reality of colonialism are also confronted. But this discussion took place after a lecture on the rise of radical politics in Indonesia around issues of social justice, equality, and also of national sovereignty in the economic sense. So the idea arose, well, why not combine the two issues? Because if you want to be have an anti-colonial attitude towards the past, you might also need to have an anti-neo-colonial attitude towards the present and the situation that actually exists in Indonesia today. So I spoke to some activists who were involved in Indonesian solidarity work in the Netherlands in 1990s from Solitaire, and there are two or three of those activists here today who have helped organize this. Harry Otten, Get, and Get Jan. And also, I was visited in Indonesia, where I live, by another Dutch activist who was also interested in this idea, who in turn spoke to another one, etc. So we now have an ad hoc group of six or seven people who organized today's event. And of course, we think it's a good, we hope it will be a good event, but of course, it's also something very experimental, I think. So that's a little bit of a tiny background to how this has come about. There are a number of, I think Marjolein will also welcome you here with a few extra ideas about how the day will go. Thank you.
So, good morning. My name is Marjolein from Pagé. I'm the founder of Historie Bersama, among other things. I'm also a historian. For now, I just want to give you a short idea about our goal for today, because I think there are more colonial legacies to discover in the Netherlands than only the most obvious, such as the street names in the Indische Buurt, Lombokstraat, where we are now. In the recent years, more and more public attention is paid to the colonial past in the Netherlands. In 2016, Dutch government decided to finance a large-scale investigation on Dutch atrocities during the Indonesian War of Independence. Museum directors and curators are wondering whether stolen artifacts should be returned. The Rijksmuseum here in Amsterdam is planning a major exhibition in 2021 on 4549. There are discussions about the question whether the images and street names of colonial perpetrators should be changed. So it's clear, despite the growing influence of right-wing political parties in the Netherlands, anti-racism groups are growing and critical decolonial voices are becoming louder. Yet, the more common the topic colonial legacies becomes, the more politicians and others in positions of power are seeking for a comfortable consensus. Thus it brings the risk that the very careful and hesitant recognition is still covering up the real politically sensitive issues, such as the Dutch refusal to recognize 1945, the exclusion of critical Indonesian voices in Dutch mainstream media, the 4.5 billion payments of Indonesia to the Netherlands, and what to think about reparations. Therefore, it is important to keep asking painful questions and to be persistent and not just to settle for nice words and half-hearted promises. That poses the questions, of course, what are the essential issues that deserve our attention? And what is striking is that, to me, is that most discussions here in the Netherlands are focusing on the past, or often focusing on the past, as if the only challenge is how to deal with injustice that took place a long time ago. While the social and economic problems of modern Indonesia have everything to do with centuries of Dutch looting and oppression, which was followed by the neo-colonial capitalist world order that determined Indonesia's path as well. Unfortunately, there is no strong solidarity anymore between Dutch and Indonesian social anti-colonial activist groups. Interestingly, this has been a little bit different in the past. Therefore, in the spirit of Sneevliet Wertheim, but also Jan Breeman, who is here with us today, we would like to reflect upon the question whether we can revive this solidarity from a decolonial perspective. And exploring these issues will be our goal for today. So I want to say enjoy the presentations. I hope there will be new facts for you to discover. Well, for the program, we all got a program there. We start with the first part with three speakers. One of the speakers will be a film, video presentation, by Francesca Patipilohi. She's 93 years old, so we thought, let's give her a break and she can, let's do it on video first. It's easier for her. But she will be here this morning, later on. Then we will see a presentation by Michael van Zijl on the 4.5 billion payments from Indonesia to the Netherlands. And followed by Jan Breeman. And then we will have a discussion from the floor and we will have a panel discussion. So I will start with the video.
We leven nu in een tijd dat decolonisatie kennelijk een discussiestuk aan het worden is, of geworden is al. Ik vind zelf, wat is decolonisatie? Betekent dat het einde van de kolonisatie? Volgens mij is er helemaal nog geen decolonisatie, in ieder geval niet van Indonesië geweest. Dat werkt tot nu toe nog door. Volgens mij is decolonisatie nog niet eens begonnen. En waarom zeg ik dat nou? Ik ben zelf geboren in 1926. En toen was het dus nog volop Nederlands-Indië. En omdat ik van het kleine handjevol Indonesiërs behoorde die van feodale afkomst waren en een bepaalde status, financiële status hadden en door de Nederlanders werden beschouwd als heel goede medewerkers aan de Nederlands-Indische kolonie. Maar dan mijn vader wist dat de Nederlandse taal een zeer belangrijk middel in het leven is en dat hij dus ons van de wieg af met Nederlands heeft opgevoed en wij hun, de taal van mijn ouders, als die met elkaar spraken, dus niet begrepen, dat was gewoon iets wat normaal was. En wij mochten wel, omdat ook hij al naar de Europese opleiding had gehad, mochten zijn kinderen ook naar de Nederlandse school. Ik ben dus gewoon naar de Nederlandse school gegaan toen ik 6 was. Ik heb dus op de lagere school eigenlijk niet veel gemerkt van het verschil tussen blank en bruin. Totdat ik op mijn 10e jaar met 2 hele lichte Indische vriendinnen naar het zwembad ging. Mijn oudste vriendinnetje kocht de kaartjes. Maar toen wij naar binnen wilden gaan, toen zei die man die de kaartjes moest controleren, die zei, zij mag niet naar binnen en hij wees naar mij. En wij keken alle drie helemaal verwonderd en heel verontwaardigd naar hem. Waarom mag zij niet naar binnen? Geef niet waarom, zij mag niet naar binnen. Mijn eerste aanraking met, jij bent bruin. En niet wit. Blijkbaar is dat ook een onderscheiding. Want mijn vader had ons wel opgevoed met, wij zijn Ambonese, geen inlanders. Ik heb helemaal nooit begrepen wat dat betekende, maar het bleek dus iets meer te zijn dan inlanders. En wij wisten wel dat inlanders waren, ons bedienden, en die waren natuurlijk wel helemaal iets lagers dan wat we zelf waren. In ieder geval, dat was dan mijn dinges van, oh, blijkbaar is een Ammonees dus niet hetzelfde als een wit. Mag niet zwemmen. Mijn tweede ervaring met het racisme was, ik wist toen niet natuurlijk dat het racisme was, maar was toen ik op de HBS zat, in de tweede klas, ik had een vriendinnetje, notabene de dochter van de officier van justitie, dat was zo'n tweede man in Nederlands-Indië. En dus heel erg belangrijke Nederlander. Hij woonde ook in een prachtig huis in de Europese rijke wijk. En die kwam op een dag naar me toe en zei, wil je met ons mee zondag, aanstaande zondag, naar de jachtclub? Ik keek haar helemaal ontzet aan. De jachtclub, zei ik. Ja, niet een prio. Ja, dat was dus de club die helemaal afgeschermd was door een hele hoog haag van de andere gedeelte van het strand, waar wel wat rijkere Indonesiërs konden komen. En daar kon je dan nog net zien hoe de prachtige jachten daar lagen. En er was een heel mooi restaurantje. En daar kwamen alleen maar de rijke witte Nederlanders. Ik was zo verbaasd dat ik zei, ik moet mijn vader vragen. Nou, ik kwam thuis, helemaal trots. Ik zei tegen mijn vader, Ina heeft mij uitgenodigd om naar de jachtclub te gaan zondag. Ik dacht dat hij blij verrast zou zijn, maar hij keek me heel streng in haar en zei, daar komt niks van in. Ik zei, waarom niet? Je wordt straks bij de poort geweigerd. Weet je nog van het zwembad? En ja, dat wist ik nog wel herinneren. Maar dat was dus mijn tweede aanraking eigenlijk met het racisme. En trouwens, ik wist wel dat wij niet hetzelfde waren als de witte leerlingen. Want ik hoorde tot de beste leerlingen van de klas. Maar we waren maar een percentage van 5 op 30 in de klas. 5 Indonesiërs en de rest was wit. En hoewel ik heel goed was, was ik toch eigenlijk niet hetzelfde als de andere leerlingen. Je hoorde er eigenlijk niet echt bij. En ik wist toen ook wel dat inlanders waren natuurlijk toch minder dan, waren eigenlijk helemaal minder. Want ik was op een keer naar school gegaan en had de rapporten moeten inleveren. Met mijn vaders credentials, omdat dat bij het begin van het schooljaar moest je het schoolgeld bepaald worden. En daar zag ik tot mijn verbazing dat in mijn rapport stond op de eerste bladzijde Francisca Patipilohi, inlands leerling. En nou ja, dat was dus voor mij wel een school. En nu begreep ik ook eigenlijk wel waarom ze mij niet zo voor vol aanzaag. Mijn volgende ervaring met zwart en wit was de bezetting van de Japanners. In maart 1942 was ik 16 jaar. De avond dat wij bezet werden, hoorden wij door de radio, Nederlands is tot nu toe een verboden taal, mag niet meer geweest worden en gesproken. En Indonesisch is de enige taal die gesproken mag worden, die gebruikt mag worden. Nou, dat was een ongelooflijke ervaring. Een paar dagen daarna was er een bekendmaking. Alle jongens en meisjes tussen de 12 en de 18 jaar die naar school zijn geweest, die moeten op een bepaalde school komen op maandag, bepaalde dag in maart. En dan moeten ze allemaal begint de Japanse cursus. Dat was voor de eerste keer dat ik naar school ging. En ik kwam binnen, moesten allemaal in banken plaatsnemen. En we zaten met z'n tienen in één bank, alleen maar Indonesische kinderen. Dat was ons, ik was zo, ik voelde me zo blij eigenlijk, heel raar. We kenden elkaar, we spraken natuurlijk wel allemaal Nederlands, want het waren allemaal leerlingen van school. Maar we vonden het zo interessant, we waren natuurlijk ook allemaal bang voor de Japanners. Dus dat was ontzettende een gevoel van solidariteit voor elkaar. Dat was voor het eerst in mijn leven. En toen werden 2 maanden daarna ook nog het bevel gegeven dat alle scholen geopend moesten worden in het Indonesisch. En dat was voor mij helemaal een ongelooflijke ervaring. Dat wij een taal hadden waar je ook heel goed een helemaal schoolopleiding in kon van. Dat we een cultuur hadden, dat wij ook liederen hadden die heel veel mooier waren dan de blakke top der duinen. En waar wij allemaal begonnen te kennen en te leren. En wat het bijzondere was wij kwamen van allerlei delen van Indonesië, maar we spraken allemaal Indonesisch. En dat was toch een hele fantastische ervaring. Ik heb het toen eigenlijk, toen ik 16 was, niet zo me gerealiseerd. Maar later, toen in 1945, op 15 augustus, de Japanners verslagen werden. En wij opeens hoorden, 2 dagen daarna, dat Sukarno de Indonesische onafhankelijkheid had uitgeroepen. Toen was ik 19. En toen opeens, werd ik me bewust, wij zijn een eigen land. Wij zijn degene die erop aankomen in het land. En Nederland is voorgoed eigenlijk verdwenen. Maar dat was dus niet waar. In oktober 1945... opeens kwamen er toch al weer een Nederlandse, in ieder geval generaal Van Mook kwam terug uit Australië. En hij bezette dus met het Nederlandse leger ook de Knil, al de helft van Batavia. Zogenaamd kwamen zij dan de orde en rust. En wij begrepen eigenlijk toen nog niet zo goed wat er aan de hand was, maar het was eigenlijk al midden. De revolutie was toen eigenlijk al begonnen. Die ervaring van die solidariteit tussen al mijn andere Indonesische medeleerlingen op die Japanse cursus is voor mij een verschrikkelijk belangrijke ervaring geweest. Die heeft stand gehouden de hele revolutie door. Toen Van Mook probeerde vanaf 1946 tijdens de Molino-conventie een federale staat met van verschillende eilandgroepen en etnische groepen die dan eigen staten zouden worden onder Nederlandse leiding, omdat ze dan tegen elkaar, omdat Nederland dan nog gebruik kon maken van het verdeel- en heerspolitiek, omdat die staten natuurlijk met elkaar zouden concurreren, maar dan wel onder leiding van Nederlanders die dan als moderator hun rol van kolonisator door konden blijven spelen. Dat is denk ik het verschrikkelijkste geweld van de kolonisatie. En ik denk dat dat een ontzettend belangrijk onderdeel is als we de decolonisatie willen gaan bestuderen en daar, willen weten wat de invloed daarvan is geweest, die 3,5 eeuw kolonisatie, op een eventuele decolonisatie en het mindset van de Indonesische bevolking die nu niet meer 65 miljoen is, maar 250 miljard mensen, het vierde land in de wereld. En dat zij toch nog steeds vechten met de invloed van de mindset van de koloniale tijd. Een belangrijke ervaring van mij was ook toen ik in 1947 door mijn vader naar Leiden werd gestuurd. Ik had toen net de HBS afgemaakt in het door het Nederlands bezette gedeelte van de Republiek in Batavia. En mijn vader stuurde mij toen naar Leiden om Indisch recht te studeren. En daar heb ik dus ontdekt hoe verschrikkelijk eigenlijk de kolonisatie in elkaar zat. En wat wij 3,5 eeuw eigenlijk niemands waren. Totdat in 1945 de Republiek werd uitgeroepen. En dat merkte ik dus ook. Ik ging weg met een paspoort Nederlands onderdaan. En ik kwam terug met 4 vellen gestenselde formulieren waarop stond Indonesisch, Republiek Indonesië. Dat was ook een ongelooflijke, fantastische ervaring eigenlijk. We gingen terug naar Indonesië, mijn man en ik. Ik was namelijk inmiddels getrouwd. En we gingen namelijk terug om de republiek, de eenheidsrepubliek op te bouwen. Tot de verdeel- en heerspolitiek zich ergens in 1965 zo heeft kunnen manifesteren dat het land ter prooi viel aan een dictator, terwijl in die 15 jaar er een 1955 de eerste conferentie aan Azië-Afrika plaatsvond, waar 29 Afrikaanse en Aziatische landen aan meededen, die allemaal van plan waren om onafhankelijkheid, als ze die nog niet hadden, te bevechten. In die tijd was er ook bijvoorbeeld de Games of the New Emerging Forces, waar ik tot de ontdekking kwam hoe geweldig hoe de Olympische Spelen eigenlijk in een kaarslicht kwamen te staan vergeleken bij wat er aanwezig was in Azië, in de hele wereld van de emerging forces. En dat is natuurlijk niet alleen Azië-Afrika, maar ook Latijns-Amerika. En dat allemaal toch teniet is gedaan door gebruikmaking van de verdeel- en heerspolitiek in heel de derde wereld door het westerse kapitaal, dat het dus eigenlijk tot nu toe nog steeds niet, het kolonialisme eigenlijk nog niet weg is.
The next speaker is already here. Yeah.
Yeah. Next will be switch.
Let me already introduce Michael a little bit. Michael is a decolonial activist and co-founder of the Majority Perspective Foundation. And for this occasion, he will talk about his findings, about what he found in the Dutch archive here in The Hague. Regarding the 4.5 billion payments from Indonesia to the Netherlands. I think that you have a lot to tell, so I will keep it very short. Enjoy the presentation.
Hello, this presentation is a shortened version of a more detailed and bigger presentation that our head of board, Christa, is going to give at Michigan University. So we do not have time to talk about everything. Because we cannot talk about everything, we published some documents that I will address. We published them online. Actually, they were published, but something went wrong. We didn't bring our laptop, but as soon as we come home, we will publish them again. You can find it there, because these other documents are also really groundbreaking. And not to lose the focus on the stuff that we want to show you, we decided not to show them in this presentation.
Control
and up
the top. So.
It's one of the research questions that comes up when you're trying to get the general picture of the economic history of the conflict.
So you did not research it yet, you mean? Or?
There's lots of publications on this issue, and we will certainly weigh them in. For instance, if you're discussing the Marshall Plan impact.
I'm just talking about, did Indonesia pay part of this 4.5 billion? That's not a hard question.
Well, it's a very hard question, because there are several answers are possible.
Well, there's only one answer possible, because we found the proof for this.
But
first I need to tell a little bit about the situation there. This was at the NIOD during a round table discussion we had. And we, as all the people that objected against the research, NIOD, Kai Teofe, and NIMH are conducting for the state. And it was a very racist situation. You can hear, obviously, that I'm really frustrated. I was also the last one to talk, so there was 2 hours of frustration build up. But I want to show this. I wanted to show that video because it clearly shows how people that claim that they have expertise in this subject don't even know the answer to the question whether Indonesia paid part of the RTC claims or not. And to show you more about the confusion that there was in the Netherlands, there's, for example, this an article published in the Groene Amsterdammer by Lambert Giebels. He's a journalist. And I didn't show the whole article again because it will distract, but there's this this claim. He says that the Dutch collective memory holds the idea that Sukarno's Indonesia refused to pay its debt. The collective memory, however, forgets that when Indonesia stopped their payments in 1956, that the remaining debt was 650 million guilders. That means that they almost paid more, about 4 billion to the Netherlands between in that period. This is one of the claims. At the same time, there's this other claim from a journalist and writer of the book Opvangen aan Dijvenlucht. For that book, she did a lot of research. And she actually says that Sukarno flat out refused to pay this. She was actually so sure that for us suggesting that Indonesia paid, we were called amateur club, and well, she wasn't that friendly, but that's also not where I want to put the focus on. But it shows that there's also confusion with her, at her. This was actually also the reason why we started to do this research, because it triggered us. Like, Marjolein actually helped with the research. Christa and Rogier also helped with researching. And Marjolein gave us some footnotes from, I think, from books you read. And with those footnotes, we went to the National Archive. And actually, we got stuck there. but thanks to Marjolein, she had a footnote that was a bit similar to what we looked for. And the librarian actually came with a book written by the grandfather of Thierry Baudet. And with the footnote, with the exact location of this document. And it is a correspondence between DBI, it's department. DBI department that it's about economics, and the main organization, actually. DBI means, I don't want to explain it because, yeah, this no longer exists, but it's sort of the organization that is responsible for all the stuff that needed to be arranged after decolonization. I'm not going to show you the whole document specifically because it will distract again, but we highlighted some important things. It clearly says that Indonesia paid. It's highlighted says the current state of the Indonesian debts that were taken over at the RTC currently is 640 million. That means when you take the begin amount from 4.5 billion, that means that Indonesia paid 3,860 million guilders in that period. And that's about the same amount as the whole Marshall help the Netherlands received. So this is actually proof that they paid. And actually they specify it. Although, yeah, it is corrected, but they used to say 820. But they corrected it to 880. Another remarkable thing in this document is the document is actually about one department warning the Netherlands for there were rumors that Indonesia wanted to nationalize Dutch companies because Indonesia found out that through these payments they paid 1.5 billion too much to the Netherlands, and this is actually a warning, the whole document, that hey, they are planning this and this and this, and there's nothing we can do about it. Plus the argumentation Indonesia had. And there's also this part that is specifically about the 2 billion that the Netherlands claimed in RTC for the police actions, which Indonesia, of course, flat out refused. The mediator from the US, Cochrane, also dismissed this 2 billion. And here they discuss about how they came up with this 2 billion they claimed at the RTC. And it says actually, according to us, the Netherlands, the police actions only costed 700 million. How they came up with the remaining amount is unknown. Seemingly, a person named Hirschfeld came up with the idea to claim extra claims during RTC. And those extra claims were actually the claims that they thought would not make it through negotiation. So they claimed stuff twice, which is fraud, which is theft. And actually, they claimed 1.3 billion guilders too much. That was the beginning, or the initial amount everything started with. So every calculation, every story about payments is actually starting from a too high amount, from 1.3 billion. This is money the Netherlands stole. And actually, I will come up with some different examples how they really wanted to steal this money, because I tried to re-steal it again. First, I want to tell you who Hirschfeld was. Hirschfeld was, during the Second World War, he was the Secretary General of Economic Affairs, and he actually got very famous in the Netherlands then. Because he came up with the guidelines that the Dutch companies should cooperate with the Nazi regime. The Netherlands also claimed that they suffered a lot during the Second World War, well, not on economic on not an economic part, because the Dutch economy grew during the Second World War. And that's because Hirschfeld made up the policy that Dutch companies should cooperate with Nazis, with fascism. Actually, he got accused also of collaboration because he spoke out against the February strikes. He said it was a bad idea, people should not go on strike. And after the Second World War, he was also dishonorably discharged because of these accusations. And although he fought that in court at the High Council, and they actually said that he was right, he wasn't a collaborator. How they came up with that is, for me, not hard to grasp, but anyway, he quit himself, honorable discharge this time, and actually the Netherlands contacted him again, especially for overseeing this RTC treaty, and so the Netherlands not only recycled fascist soldiers to go to Dutch Indonesia. They also did this with the high people that work at the high ministries and all. And he actually, because he got reinstated because there were no other people with the experience. That's the same excuse they use to send out these SS soldiers to the police actions. Also, he became the person that overlooked the distribution of the Marshall Notes. So this person really was a really important really important for Dutch history, actually. This concerns the documents that we did not show. If you want to know more about this, then you should go to the website and all, and you can download them. But we found also evidence in this archive that the Netherlands used the money that Indonesia reclaimed, because Indonesia reclaimed this money by nationalizing companies, the 1.5 billion that they thought they calculated that they paid too much. And the Netherlands started a trade embargo and put a lot of international pressure on other countries like the United States not to go into trade with Indonesia. And even worse, during the economic situation there, with famine, and the Dutch actually went to countries and said, hey, you should not offer aid to countries that have debts, that do not pay their debts. Well, these weren't debts, this was money Indonesia claimed back. So this is one of the ways they tried to re-steal the money that Indonesia claimed back. But they did the same at Wassenaar Treaty. About Wassenaar Treaty, there is not much documented, but we do know, and we also found, that the Netherlands tried to re-steal it through the Wassenaar Treaty, because first the Wassenaar Treaty was 4.5 billion, and in the end it was 650 million that remained of that claim. And they say that it was Dutch generosity. Well, we found that it was not Dutch generosity. It was just the parties at the treaty. They knew what the Netherlands were up to, and they said, we are not going to do this. The whole amount was lowered to 650 million. That is where this Luns quote from it was Dutch generosity came from. It was just a smoke screen. And I see Marjolein standing there, so I have to finish. But the last part is, we also found a lot of documents. We put the Linggadjati Treaty next to the RTC treaty, and they're actually almost the same. And the only thing that is different between them is that in between there were these military campaigns, which hundreds of thousands of people died. And we wanted to NIOT to research how this stolen money contributed to the Agressie Militaire Belang, actually. And that's the part that I really wanted to go further into detail, but I think if there are researchers here that will jump on this, because this is really important for the history, I think, for our colonial history. It was a really shortened presentation, and I hope that's clear that the implications of our findings, and we will make sure that before today ends that we will put it online again. So.
Thank you, Michael. The next speaker, Jan Breeman, he will first talk about colonialism as racism, but maybe you already saw on the workshop that there is a workshop by him, but that is unfortunately cancelled. It's not feeling too well today, so we're very happy that he still is able to come. So after his first talk on colonialism as racism, he will add a short presentation about their time. Do you want to stand here or prefer to sit?
Would you allow me to sit down?
Yes, of course. Sure.
Starts with a quote which should be on the label of man. The first quote is what I would focus on for the moment. The most important colonial statemaker the Netherlands has ever had was J.C. Bout. J.C. Bout, who made his career in the early 20th century, in the 19th century already, when he became a civil servant in the ministry in the Netherlands, which handled colonial affairs. And he rose in the ranks of that department. And he was the successor to Johannes van den Bosch, when he stepped down as the founding father of the cultivation system. He was succeeded by Bout, who came from The Hague and said he was willing to become governor general to consolidate the cultivation system, which he did, and with increasing profits for the Dutch treasury. Having served his stint in the Netherlands Indies, he came back to the Netherlands as Minister of Colonial Affairs. And that he was again for a couple of years. He stepped down as Minister of Colonial Affairs in 1848, when a major political turnaround took place, a major political reconfiguration took place in the Netherlands. A constitutional monarchy was announced. And he stepped down together with King Willem I, who was a dictator, and he had ruled the colonies in collusion with the governor general. He stepped down as Minister of Colonial Affairs, and in his memorandum of resignation, he wrote up the first quote, which I have translated from the original Dutch. That shows the out-and-out racist ideology underlying colonialism. And you have to take into account that the Netherlands was not an exception. What the Dutch did in the Netherlands Indies, the British did in many parts of the world, the French also, and the Germans as a latecomer also tried to follow in the footsteps of the colonizing nations of Europe. Basically, the right to domination over the world, which was what they acclaimed, the right to domination over the world, over peoples who were considered not to be civilized, who were considered to be backward, who were considered to be lower, of a different race. Bout, it's very interesting, he doesn't get the same, what shall I say, publicity as Kuhn or Daendels or Van den Bosch, but he was more important, he was more influential, laying out the tenets on which colonial domination had to be fixed, racism. And he remained active also after he had stepped down then as Minister of Colonial Affairs. He became the founding father of the KITLV, the Koninklijk Instituut of Taalland en Volkenkunde in Leiden, in 1851, when the institute was founded with him as the founding father and also as the president of the Board of Trustees until 1857. And in founding the KITLV, it was not yet royal when it was started, but it became royal. He also wrote up the mission which should guide what the Institute had to do. And that is the second quote, which I invite you to read if you have not already done that. His interest to set up an institute which would collect information, intelligence on native lore and customs was not meant to be a scholarly one. It was not for scholarly reasons that the institute was set up. The designed ambit was to gather policy-relevant knowledge on the fabric of the native economy, society and culture for the sake of keeping control over the occupied domain and its inhabitants. It aimed at alienating the Indonesian people from their own history, as you have said in the interview, in alienating the Indonesian people from their own history and identity. Dutch rule should endure with the least possible friction in order to realize the highest economic profit at minimal cost. This was the mission with which the KITLV was equipped. The collection of intelligence on native life and lore had instrumental utility and was meant to yield an annual budget surplus which would flow into the coffers of the Metropolitan Treasury. Java had to remain, as Bout said it, the cork on which the Netherlands floats. It's interesting, and it has already been said, that the colonial legacy has disappeared from public discussion. as if there was no imprint left, neither in Indonesia nor in the Netherlands. I won't, in what I'm saying now, speak on the aftermath of colonialism in the Netherlands. I mainly focus on what it meant for Indonesia, the colonial legacy, but also for the Netherlands, that has been important. It's very interesting if you go to the literature on the Dutch identity. What is the Dutch identity? What is the Dutch social or national identity? That is hotly debated in politics, isn't it? And there is a variety of opinions. But in that literature, the colonial legacy does not play a major role. It remains highly understated. And I refer you to an excellent book on the Dutch identity by a colleague of mine, a friend of mine also, Piet de Rooij, professor of history, modern history at Amsterdam University, who published a couple of years ago a book on the Dutch identity. The colonial relationship is not discussed at all. As if, as has already been said in the presentation, Netherlands has never gone overseas. But while you look at the street names, and certainly in this neighborhood, it's very clear. Also think of the colonial museums, which were transformed into Third World museums. Much to my regret. I suggest that we need a colonial museum to remind us of the past, of what has happened. And we shy away from either setting up a slavery museum or a colonial museum. Next week there will be a discussion in Amsterdam on the decolonization of Belgium, the Museum of Ter Vuren. I don't know if you've been there. I've been there on a number of occasions when it was still firmly colonial, and I think it should go back to that exhibition, to that kind of exhibition, where the natives were indeed shown as inferior, as uncivilized, as backward. The pretension of equality is there, but it is denied not only in practice, but also in ideology. And attention has already been drawn to the Forum for Democracy, a new political party in the Netherlands, which regrets that the glorious past of the Netherlands, of our civilization, is not acknowledged. And its racial supremacy. It's very interesting, you know, it's not only in street names and statues and musea, which are around in the Netherlands everywhere, that we are reminded of the colonial past. The way it has left an imprint on political ideology is important. It's important to sort out where this kind of racism has its roots, has its origin. And I think that colonialism plays a major role in that. what Bout wrote in the middle of the 19th century was a racist declaration of the right to dominate. Not only, as I repeat that, not only by the Dutch, but by Europe at large. I'm working on another figure in that landscape, which articulated it in a very powerful way, Alexis de Tocqueville, a French political philosopher around the 1830s, 1840s, until the 1850s, but also a professional politician. He even became Minister of Foreign Affairs in France. And he is known in the social science literature as the man who paved the way for democracy. That is his reputation. But there are other sides to his reputation which remain in the shadow. His unadulterated racism and his preaching of the need to colonize the world outside Europe for the greater glory of the motherland. Not only to reap profits, rich profits, as the cultivation system, but also the need of colonialism to express the domination and the greater glory of the motherland. As I said, I won't elaborate on the imprint colonialism has left in Europe. But it is a powerful one, it is an important one. And we are facing that today. But what has been the aftermath of colonialism on Indonesia? That is certainly an understated question. But it is an important one. Towards the end of the 19th century, the quotes which are shown lost their validity. A new ideology of colonialism took over. The White Man's Burden by Rudyard Kipling. La vocation civilisatrice in France. And the ethische politiek, the ethical policy in the Netherlands. It was the realization that until then, colonialism had impoverished the country and the people where it was ruling. Not only in the Netherlands Indies, but also in the Netherlands Indies, as Queen Wilhelmina, after the turn of the century, declared in her annual speech. Indonesian people had become poorer under colonialism, not better off. And that gave rise, that statement, that understanding gave rise to a new colonial ideology, which was what was called in English the dual mandate. The dual mandate. Why dual? Well, the colonial profits had to continue, and even higher than they had been in the 19th century. But the native people had also to benefit from colonial rule. They had to become civilized. They had to become educated. They had to become able to produce more than they had done so far. The dual mandate, which in French is discussed as la mise en valeur, to put to value that which has no value. As I said, la vocation civilisatrice, civilizing the colonized people, educating them, showing them the road to a better future. That was the declaration of the ethical policy in the Netherlands Indies. It came to nothing. It was never implemented, and it was stalled and sabotaged from within the colonial apparatus. Not only because the white elite in the colonies were dead set against it, but also the colonial policymakers, the civil servants, did not really believe that should be the road to follow. The ethical policy was aborted. And the Netherlands Indies changed into a police state, into a regime of apartheid between brown and white. And that had to do, of course, with the emergence of the nationalist movement from the beginning of the 20th century. That was seen as a major danger to Dutch rule and had to be stopped, had to be suppressed. What could not be tolerated was the mobilization of the people by its leaders to struggle for freedom, to insist on independence. That could not be tolerated. And the Netherlands Indies turned into a police state with the PID, the Political Intelligence Service, a department which kept under close surveillance what went on in the colony and which resisted the organized protest which the leadership of the national movement tried to set up.
Sorry to interrupt. Do you plan to talk about Wertheim as well in this panel or later?
I think that will be done in the afternoon, but if you give me 5 minutes,
yes,
then I'm done. Yeah?
Please.
A police state. An apartheid regime. And we have heard examples what that meant in day-to-day life, in day-to-day encounter. Before the apartheid regime in South Africa came up, introduced by Verwoerd, the apartheid regime already existed in the Netherlands Indies. And you read about it in the writings of Wim Wertheim. And you listen to the interview which you saw videoed. The pretension was kept up that yes, we want to pave the way to a better future for the Indonesian people who are not able to do that on their own. They need Dutch coaching and guidance. The pretension was kept up. And that's why decolonization was also considered to be, as it was called in the Netherlands, a mission interrupted. Our mission to bring civilization, to bring progress, had failed because the leaders of the nationalist movement did not allow colonial rule to continue as it had done in the past. It's very interesting. Well, after decolonization came the Third World, isn't it? In which Europe and the West at large proclaimed that it would help the Third World to catch up. The mission had to be continued, because behind that promise, that pledge of development assistance, the real motivation was hidden, and that was to continue the domination of the West. I can't elaborate on that. Wim Wertheim has done that. Already at an early stage, he said that development aid is a form of neocolonialism. Looking back on that important moment in time in the mid-20th century, the decolonization, it seems as if that was a natural process. It could not be abandoned. This cry for freedom, it could not be resisted in the end. So decolonization was a natural phenomenon, and the colonizing powers had to give in, to concede that yes, now another era has come. What is overlooked in the discussion on decolonization is the resistance to it from the colonizing nations. In the Netherlands, a very important moment was the launching of the National Committee on the Restoration, of Territorial Integrity. De Nationale Commissie tot Herstel van de Rijkseenheid, which was set up in 1946. By a very powerful political caucus belonging to the right already then. Christian Democratic Parties and the party which called themselves liberal, but which were of course conservative already then. There was even an attempt at a coup d'etat in the Netherlands in 1946. That is known, but it has been understudied in what it meant, what its backing was, and why it failed. The coup d'etat failed. It never came about. Because at the highest possible level, the monarchy, it was decided not to collaborate with it. But the lobby behind the coup d'etat...
Because we have only until 12 to have the panel discussion with the rest.
Sorry,
so
yeah.
I hope you can...
Okay. The coup d'etat failed, but the lobby behind the coup d'etat remained very powerful. And this explains why there was a turn in the encounter between the Indonesian delegates and the Dutch delegation, hardening the conditions, the negotiations of a compromise. And that led to the police actions, which have already been talked about. Indonesia was left shattered, dirt poor, devastated, destroyed in its apparatus, infrastructure, and all that. But it had to pay the cost of the war, which had been fought in the Netherlands. And in addition to what has been already told before, Goebbels brought that up already many years ago. One of the conditions of the settlement was that the Dutch wanted to be reimbursed for the cost of the war, and it was a high cost to a poor country. But that is not the only heritage that colonialism has left. The Indonesian people were not incorporated in a policy and a political frame leading towards democratization. They were never able to understand the complexities of democracy, and certainly not the complexities of the struggle for equality. So that is also the imprint of colonialism. Not only a dirt poor country and a dirt poor population, but also a gap between the rich and the poor. And that gap has never been broached. It's not only that. I did fieldwork, anthropological fieldwork, in the late 1980s and early 1990s in Java.
Maybe we
in Central Java.
Have this discussion with the two other speakers present. Is that okay for you?
I thought we had to 12 o'clock, isn't
no,
it?
No, but to have the discussion with the
okay,
room
yeah.
and with the rest of the speakers.
But I just wanted to say this about the heritage of the colonial army. Trained to fight a people who belong to their own race. And that, in that way, I saw, when I was doing my village research, I saw how it was still during the New Order regime, how the army behaved to the population. It was not an army of the population. It was an army turned against the population. That is also the heritage of colonialism. Thank you. Sorry.
Michael and Tante, if you want, can take place here, and then let's give the opportunity to the room to ask questions. Are there questions already?
Of language that Andersiska has been putting forward, and learning Dutch is very important at the time. And I know in the other occasion, Professor Breman also mentioned about language, which was that the strange thing was that Indonesia was the biggest colony, Dutch biggest colony overseas, and yet people in Indonesia doesn't speak Dutch. I mean, Andersiska, of course, belonged to the small elite of the Indonesian society who speaks Dutch. In contrast, with the Suriname, they always speak Dutch. And now, I mean, most of the Indonesian here, they don't speak Dutch. So if Professor Breman mentioned something about the legacy of colonialism, how about this language issue? Is it not also a legacy of it, that we don't speak Dutch? If in contrast, you mentioned with French and with Mission Civilisatrice in France and in Maghreb, Morocco, Tunisia, and Algiers, those countries already speaks already Arabic, because the Dutch I know that the Dutch always say that, they already speak Malay, so we don't need to impose our own language. And yet the French did the same, imposing their language in Maghreb, you know, as the main colony of France at that time, meaning that in Maghreb, they still speak French now. The higher education in there is bilingual, French and Arabic. And not in Indonesia, because Indonesia is that we already have Indonesian Malay, so we don't need Dutch. And yet they speak Dutch in Suriname. So how is this language issue as colonial legacy? Thank you.
Let me first collect two more questions and then the answers.
It wasn't exactly clear, at least from my side, on how when the money was asked after the war, what was the like the Dutch perspective out of it? I mean, how did they justify the request for the money? I mean, it was a new state, so they said like you asked money. When was the request first initiated, and how did they justify it from the Dutch perspective?
Another.
Yeah, I have a question to Michael. When you were telling about the fact that the Indonesian government had to sign this financial settlement with the Dutch government, I was wondering who was leading the Indonesian government, because you said
Hatta.
Yeah. How come that he signed this treaty with Holland while in 1956 under Sukarno? Sukarno actually stopped, you know, he actually came with the decision to stop paying the Dutch back. So what is the reason that Hatta, you know, agreed with this treaty, and how come that Sukarno was against it, and in between there was, you know, it took like 7 years before the Indonesian government stopped paying.
Yeah.
And my second question is to Professor Raymond. You mentioned about the fact that in Holland certain forces wanted to stage a coup d'etat, and the royal family was against it, it stopped the implementation of the coup d'etat. I was wondering who were the forces behind this coup d'etat? Thank you.
Okay. So we have three questions, two about the payments and one about the language issue. Who wants to answer first?
Ik kan niet zo goed horen.
What's the taal? The question about the language. Do you have
a
professor?
For me, I can try to do it in English.
Well, as I said, the ethical policies promised to civilize the people, to educate them. But as I also said, the ethical policy was never implemented. So not much came about educating the population. As a matter of fact, a professor at Utrecht University wrote in 1926-1927, when a revolt had broken out in 1926-27. And he said, this is the consequence of education. You make people dissatisfied. You make them impatient. So stop it. That's one dimension of the language question. But another dimension is that, yes, you are schooled and educated in Dutch. But what does it mean in the world? The knowledge of Dutch. The Indonesian people had the unfortune to become civilized in a provincial mindset. Still, the world was not open to them. And I still think of a very prominent historian who, about two decades ago, told me, why do you keep on writing in English? Foreigners who want to know about Indonesia will have to learn Dutch. I never write in English. the provincial mindset of colonialism should also come up as an interesting dimension of the Dutch variety of colonialism. A provincial mindset.
Yeah. May I want to say something about the Dutch opinion about the uncivilized population that Indonesia was. They say very often in to get a little bit off of their guilt, Dutch people very often say to me, yeah, but colonialism has also brought hospitals. They made roads, very big and beautiful roads, the plantations, who got all. But what I say is that some 200,000 white colonial people have never built the roads. They didn't build the hospitals. They didn't build the palaces that are beautiful there in Indonesia. They didn't plant the plantations and kept it. That was all done by the uncivilized natives. So it's a very, that is the most criminal heritage that we have got from colonialism, is the mindset. The mindset that the black people are a very low, very much unknown and very uncivilized. Well, what can I say more? So the problem for Indonesia is it is at the moment the fourth biggest nation in the world, but they only knew if they got a moment of education, it was an education in Dutch. They learned that the Rhine came into our country by Lobit, you know? So for the Indonesian people, the only thing that they know, and I think that's a very important thing, that from Sabang till Merauke, they speak Indonesian, one language, but they have to catch up 3.5 age of not being able to get any education. It was forbidden when the national movement started in the 30s to open their own schools. The Sukarno, Hatta, Syahrir were banned to Papua and to the Indonesian people only got the opportunity to get education when the Japanese tried to colonize Indonesian instead of the Dutch. But they needed the Indonesian language, so they needed also an educated people, and that's why what Indonesia started to get education in 1942. In 1942, there were 65 million Indonesians, and only 5% could read and write. So that is our colonial heritage.
Thank you, Tante Siska. This was about, is this your answered your question about language? Okay. I think the interesting thing about this discussion about language is also, if I may add something, is that it may sound as if we give the example of France and
one,
British.
Yeah. One thing is, now Indonesian students get the also the opportunity to study in the Netherlands. But they only can study in English, because that's the language which they have mastered after the independence. But they can't read their own history, which is very ample existent in the Dutch archives and libraries, because that's in Dutch. And that's the most, criminal inheritance that we have from the colonials.
That's my point, actually. That's
okay.
My point. Thank you.
Okay.
That was his point.
Is that enough?
Yeah. You want to add something about that, or change to the?
I want to add something really fast, because from an activist perspective, I see this a lot. I think that it's very important that we, when we publish stuff about this subject, do this in English, because Dutch is such a it's meant for a very small group of population of the planets, and so all the trouble that we face here in the Netherlands with racism and all don't make it in the foreign media and or international media, and it does happen more when you write stuff in English. So
absolutely.
I would advise everybody to write in English when you write about this.
That was also the motivation behind Historie Bersama, for example, that there is this language gap, and we have to deal with it. And what I wanted to add about the discussion on language is that when we, it's always risky to compare with French or British colonizations, because it may sound as if it was a better way. I think there is no better way when we talk about colonialism. So when we give examples of, well, the French taught their language to the colonized people, it doesn't mean that that makes it better or less problematic. So I think there are just the different issues. I mean, this is a very specific issue between Indonesia and the Netherlands. And I learned from Jos that Indonesia is the only country in the world that was colonized that did not take over or only 5% learned the language of the colonizer. I think we are only 5 minutes before lunch, so I think we should...
lunch is slightly delayed, so we can go to 12:10.
Oh, okay. That's good to know. We have more room for discussions, so lunch is about 15 minutes from now. Maybe we can change to the answer of the questions about the debts. The first one was, how did the Dutch legitimize their claim? What was the reason that they could say and get away with it, we want this 4.5 billion? And the second one was...
I remember the second one. I didn't hear the first one. Actually, that is something we were looking also for. The only thing that is described about this RTC treaty is that they roughly estimated their claims. So there is no, we did not find any specification about the claims. We only found the amount and that they were roughly estimated. And now, with that document that we showed, we have more details about how they formed this claim, but not how they legitimized this claim, actually. And also, you need to know that the Netherlands had claims, but on the other hand, Indonesia also had claims, and the negotiators were needed to choose between one and other, and they made compromises in between. So this is probably why there is no specific specification about what they claimed and how they legitimized it. So
I think the simple way they explained it was that, now you want to have your own country, you have to take over the colonial debt. I think that's also the simple explanation.
Coming to the next question also. You asked me about why... first, Indonesia didn't agree, and then they did. But are you referring to the RTC treaty, or?
Yeah.
Okay. First of all, actually, Sukarno did agree with everything because they already signed the Linggadjati treaty, and actually, Dutch politicians ended this with a motion which they accepted. And they ended this treaty, which gave sovereignty over Java, I don't know by heart the specific regions. But the Dutch ended this treaty, and the day afterwards, they started the police actions. And the thing that is negotiated in RTC is quite similar to the agreements Sukarno did agree with in the Lunga Jati Treaty. So this is also why we think there is this important link between the police actions, and this amount, because they stopped this treaty with a motion, and there was nothing changed in between except for this violence, and then all of a sudden the Dutch do sign this treaty that was almost exactly the same as the Lunga Jati treaty. So that gives room for I think you should, especially this research team, should check this, because this police actions can be could be used to enforce more like a threat, actually. Like, if you're not going to pay, we're going to continue this violence. So you're going to need to sign this treaty, or maybe it was used to, like, hey, we can use this war to add more claims to it, because they will never check it. This is a part where I think that the historians should check, because if that's the case, then this stolen money also added to the genocide that was committed there. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, and what was the reason that in 1956 the
Indonesian government stopped something? I'm not sure. I can tell you what the Dutch thought was, and what the Dutch said. Actually, it unfolded in history. So what the Dutch predicted in this document actually happened.
That on Indonesian side found out.
That's what I want. But that's speculation from the Dutch side.
Yeah, that's
so
what
but this is not.
Saying.
These are not facts, because we don't have Indonesian parties confirming this. But I believe it happened like that, because all the other stuff happened that they predicted. Indonesia calculated also the cost of the police actions, and they calculated them at 3.5 billion, where the Netherlands said they were 700 million. And that would mean that the amount that the US negotiator took off the claims, the 2 billion, was too low. So they should have taken off 3.5 billion of the RTC claims. So that would remain 3 billion only left to pay for Indonesia.
And then can I ask you another question? Uh-huh. Because now we're talking about this amount and paying that. I mean, paying for colonization.
Yeah,
is
it's ridiculous.
To begin with,
of course.
Ridiculous, right? It's so, what are your thoughts about that? Can you share your? Restoration payments or.
I do believe that the Netherlands should pay this back. I believe that they should pay this back in equity. So everything that, not only the money they stole, but also the interest and the development that Indonesia didn't get because they didn't have this money. The Netherlands should all pay that. I'm pretty convinced that the Netherlands, the government today, is still aware that they stole that money back then, and that they will not want to give back this money, because in 2014, I think, they wrote this report about the Wassenaar Treaty payments.
Oh, that's 2004.
Yeah. So
just 1 year before Foreign Minister Ben Bot went to Indonesia to say to express his regrets, not his apologies. So that's an interesting time.
Actually, what the Dutch say in that report is it's quite normal that we ask Indonesia to pay debts, because the United States also did it and France also did it. That's their legitimate.
Yeah, because other colonizers did that, it is
exactly
normal. Yeah.
You talk about the ban bot, the de facto acknowledgement, or also during this speech, ban bot refers to a quote of Winston Churchill, which is like, yeah, sorry, but it's another subject, but yeah, the Netherlands just should pay, and we will try to do our best to let them pay.
May I add a little bit?
Yes.
I said before that all this the buildings and so on and the plantations have been built by Indonesian. The mines were also worked by Indonesian workers. I think they get very little pay or not at all. If you add that to the debt, I think that will be a little bit more.
I agree.
Are there more questions?
There was.
Sorry,
there was one question which has not yet been answered.
Oh, I thought.
On the coup d'état in the Netherlands.
Maybe you can answer, and I'm walking there.
Yeah,
that
sure.
There was one question about.
Your question on the coup. Which failed in the Netherlands. Who were the forces behind it? We know them. They're very clear. The first place, Gerbrandy, who was the Dutch prime minister in London during the occupation. He belonged to the ultra-conservative Christian Democratic Party, and he was the instigator of the coup. But he, of course, rallied for support. And support was given by big business, by agro business, mining companies, the Royal Bataafse Petroleum Company, the forerunner of the Shell. So big business was financing and also supporting the cause for the coup. And finally and importantly also military leadership of the Dutch army. What you should not forget in this whole episode is that colonialism was not only against the freedom for the Indonesian people, it was also against any progressive political ideology, even if it would be social democracy, let alone further. We should not forget the heroes also in the Netherlands, for instance, the soldiers who were mobilized to fight Indonesia, and who said, we won't do that because we have just resisted occupation, German occupation. We won't go to Indonesia to do that. Those heroes, you know, so much, it's not only the dissenters, but so much is swept under the carpet in mainstream history, of which we need to bring up in order to understand the total context. Colonialism was vehemently anti-labor in Indonesia. And I refer you to the work of John Ingelson, In Search of Justice, In Search of Social Justice, an Australian historian who wrote the history of the trade union movement in the Netherlands Indies and how they were resisted and suppressed by the Dutch power. Don't forget that the Dutch Social Democratic Party had just come to power shortly after the war in the Netherlands. They had been blocked from political power before that. But after after German occupation, social democracy became one of the leading parties in the Netherlands. But those who plotted the coup were dead set against social democracy also. They want Indonesia as it had been, a domain of the Dutch, and a laboring population which was not given its due, fair wages, the right to representation, the right to organization, the right to share in the profits of growth. And that same ideology again has lingered on after independence in Indonesia. The state of Indonesia, certainly from 1965 onwards, has been vehemently opposed against the emancipation of labor. And that cannot be understood without contextualizing this question in the history of colonialism.
Another question here?
Yes, another question for your name is Michael?
Yes.
The whole time I'm thinking, I don't understand this issue of death with which Indonesia has to pay. How in comparison with other countries like India, had they to pay anything? I don't understand, because if the Dutch government thinks Indonesia has to pay for what, I don't know. And also, as they calculated, 300 years of profit, which he took out of Indonesia, so I think the Netherlands has to pay into the other balance. Is that okay? I don't understand. How come this idea of paying to the Netherlands? I think it's otherwise around.
Yeah.
Of course.
But
it's the white European countries that decide. So, actually, I can explain you where these debts came from. This was loans that the colonial government made by other countries like the United States or like, actually they wanted to make sure this was arranged before they started this United States of Indonesia, and then they wanted that treaty to decide who was responsible for these costs. And actually Indonesia got a little bit got forced because it was in exchange for their sovereignty. But also Indonesia was really far, was willing to go far in their compromises. And that is why they agreed to this. I think if they had more time and less pressure on it, then this wouldn't be the outcome.
Next question here.
Yes. It's relating to the question in the back, I know. Thank you. In the Caribbean, there's 15 countries who made a coalition to basically ask for reparations to France, Dutch, and English government for reparations for slavery and colonization. So taking the few hundred years into account, is there such an initiative taking place that asks for these kind of reparations that you know of? That, or maybe there has been a point in history where this has been asked. And maybe I want to add something to the guy in the back who added about language in Suriname. It's also interesting because first the Dutch language was also forbidden to learn in for the Afro population and the enslaved population there, because it was considered with hierarchy and whiteness, etc. And it was after abolishment of slavery in 1863 that they enforced people to learn Dutch, and then they forbid their own language, Sranan. And that was because when slavery ended and people would be free, they didn't want people to just go about their lives, but to learn the Dutch way. So they had to be, I think in their own policy words, was omgeschoold tot vrije arbeiders. So they had to be educated to free Dutch-like civilized people. So that's maybe also to put in perspective when language is put as an instrument. And also the enslaved had to pay the enslavers with free labor for 10 years. And the master enslavers were compensated, I think, with also money from Indonesia. So, yeah, this is compensating the wrong people.
And to add, before 1863 in the Caribbean, in Suriname, the enslaved, if they want to become a free man, to add what you say about the Caribbean in Suriname, before 1863, if you want to be a free man as an enslaved, they had to pay a lot. And one of the reasons was also you have to become Christian. Mm-hmm. Because if you have to pay the slave owner and become Christian and then pay a lot and whatever. So there were people in Suriname who did that because they want to be a free man. And there were also Surinamese families at that time. They were not Surinamese because they were not a people. They were a thing. They had no legal status, and there were families who were contributing to buy their freedom, but it took a long time. So it's complicated, and also Suriname, the local original people were the Amerindians, and all the people who came there were from other countries. So it took hundreds of years to create a mutual language, mutual addition. Thank you.
So your question was if there are initiatives here in the Netherlands or related
or
to international
or countries that are demanding reparations.
I do not know about other initiatives, to be honest. I do know that our community is a pretty tough community, pretty still mentally colonized, and the most of the aggression we face is actually from people from our community. So it is hard to start something like this.
And you're talking about a community in the Netherlands, right?
The Dutch Indonesian diaspora, the Indos. Also because their indigenous identity has been erased because of the whitewashing of their identity that was obligated actually by the Dutch state. I can tell you that we are working with parties in Indonesia to get this story out, and the people that we are in contact with that are in Indonesia, they are actually well connected, and they are trying to gather activists, higher officials, to see if we can do something about this reparations situation. But for that also, I think we need to add, because the Dutch, they actually took over the debts of the VOC and all their possessions. That means that also the period that the VOC enslaved people and the colonized people should be added to these claims, because the Dutch...
I remember in that report from 2004, it's a Dutch government report, but they write it, is that there was an Indonesian party, but I asked around, but people do not really know who that was, who demanded 126 billion American dollars, I believe, and brought that claim to the Dutch embassy in Jakarta. But we never heard what happened to that, or if there was a...
We actually found correspondence about this between higher officials and I don't remember who they bumped into, but it was actually during the period that there was a lot of fuss about West Papua. And they report this incident and they just laugh at it. They think it's ridiculous. How did they come up with it? And that's still the status quo today, the mindset of the Dutch.
In 1980, the Center for the Study of European Expansion, that's an institute in Leiden, the Center for the Study of European Expansion, there is a kind of claim behind that, underlying that title, that expansion was natural and had to occur in order to civilize the world at large. So in that conference, the question was raised, what is the origin of underdevelopment in the global south? What is the origin of underdevelopment? And the grandfather of Thierry Baudet, who took part in that conference, together with Vasseur, wrote an article saying that these people lack the capability to develop to a better future. It was a denial of the drain. The drain, the surplus taken out of the global south.
has been consistently denied from the global north. The message still is, we went there to bring civilization, not to profit. So don't ask for any reclaims. It will be interesting for you to know that the rich profits from the cultivation system, how were they spent in the Netherlands? By not introducing an income tax. The state treasury had enough money from the colony, and it was not necessary until the end of the 19th century to introduce an income tax for the citizens of the Netherlands. In the second place, the construction of railways in the Netherlands was financed out of the colonial surplus. And in the third place, to compensate the owners of slaves in the West Indies for the loss of their property when slavery was abolished in 1863. So, basically, not the slaves, but the owners were compensated for the end, for the abolition of slavery. Basically, the sweat, the toil, and the blood of the people in the Netherlands Indies was used to compensate for the end to a system of unfree labor in the West Indies. In the same way that it has been done in France. There is a logic behind that. And there is so much not written up in mainstream history, which you need to know in order to fully contextualize what happened and what did not happen.
Can I just comment on the question relating to why the debt was rejected in the late, in the mid-50s? I think during the process of negotiations, not all Indonesian political forces agreed with the compromises that were made. Three of the main compromises being pay that debt, allow Dutch companies to get their property back that they built up during their period of colonial occupation, and Papua would not be in the first Indonesia. Almost immediately after the Dutch power left, the left wing of Indonesian politics started campaigns on all three demands, starting almost in 1950. Get merebut kembali Papua, get Papua back, repudiate the debt, nationalize the Dutch company. So that was a packet of three demands for the Indonesian Communist Party, the left wing of the Indonesian Nationalist Party, and smaller left wing parties all campaigned for from the early 50s. And I think was under that pressure of mass campaigning from 1950 until 56, 57, that finally the remainder of the debt, which a lot had been paid already, as Michael pointed out, was repudiated. So I think you have to also look to the role of the Indonesian masses mobilizing as one of the reasons why that debt was repudiated.
Thank you. I just heard that the lunch is ready. So I think we have to close this part of the panel. And I just want to say that before we go back in the room again, so let's take a break for 1 hour. So be back about 1 hour and we start again. So we're running out a little bit later on the schedule.